rhythm of the city has been disrupted, and it was one of those sudden situations that affected our city in this last week. It affected us as an organization and our team and our volunteers, but praise the Lord, we're here today, and there's no place to be than in the house of the Lord. I believe it. I want to encourage us today. Today our service is going to look a little different. We're going to spend a lot more time in worship and in prayer. We're going to take some time to just reflect on the Lord and actually position ourselves on Him, because in the middle of chaos, the best place to view is the one who's stable. And the best place to stand is on the rock.
Amen.
Where we are not shaken and we are not moved. And I know many of us are carrying the weight of maybe personal things that you're experiencing. Maybe you yourselves have been disrupted and displaced. Maybe you have friends and family who have been displaced, and we're just caring about the actual anxiety that the whole situation creates. And you're feeling the pressure in the city. And I want to say that the Lord is with us. Would you say that? The Lord is with us. The Lord is with us. We're not alone. The Lord is with us. He is the Prince of Peace. He's the Counselor. He's our support. He's our helper in times of need. He's the one who can become our advocate and our friend and the one who carries us. And what I've come to realize is that in the most disruptive of times, it's when the Lord comes through the most. When we're at our weakest, He comes through the greatest. So we're going to keep worshiping. We're going to keep praising. We're going to keep praying. We're not going to stop. We're going to continue to lift Him up and lift up His name and continue to praise Him, because whether it's in difficult, conflicting times or whether it's in the good times, the Lord always comes through for us. So would you bow your heads with me today? Father, we just thank You today for Your presence. We thank You that You are ever present with us, and that we are not alone in the trials, in the adversities, in the sense of the unknown. Lord, we trust in You. We put our trust in You. And You said that whoever puts their trust in You will not be put to shame, will not be left alone, will not be left bewildered. Lord, we believe today that You are our solid rock, and where there's anxiety and displacement, Father, today we place our feet upon You. We place our attention on You, our focus on You. We look to You as the one who supports and redeems and restores and causes us to celebrate and have joy. Lord, even though there's a system of mourning, Father, we thank You today that You've come to touch our heart, to move us from a place, Lord, of our own perspective to seeing from Your perspective in this moment. So, Lord, would You start with us first? Would You start with me first? Father, as we move forward, as we enter into Your presence today, as we draw from You, Lord, we ask for a heavy rain, Lord, not just in the natural, but, Lord, in the spiritual. Lord, pour into our hearts today. Pour into our lives today. Lord, we open up our hearts to receive fully from You in Jesus' name. And everyone who agrees, would you just say amen? Amen. Amen. Would you say amen again? Just say amen. So be it. Amen.
Moving in our midst, I worship You.
stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working.
blessed assurance. Jesus is mine. He's been my fourth man in the fire, time after time. Born of His Spirit, washed in His blood, and what He did for trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. I trust in God, my Savior. Submission.
Well, I just want to read a scripture to you this morning. Just one that's been in my heart, probably crossed your mind this week with all the chaos that's been happening in our city and our surrounding areas. I know there's a lot of emotions, that's for sure. I've dealt with a lot of emotions this week, highs and lows, that's for sure. But one thing that's important is, and it's in this verse, it's in Philippians 4:6. It says, do not be anxious about anything. Do not be anxious. And I was walking out my door this morning, and it's, I don't know about you, but like, it just feels like there's just like, as soon as I walked out the door, it's like this heaviness just hits you. And it feels like it's just kind of cast over this place, and it's cast over Kelowna. But I just want to, in this moment, I don't want to let the circumstances dictate my faith. I don't want to let circumstances dictate, you know, it might dictate my emotions for a moment, but we did something this morning that I feel like is in this verse. And we stood around the circle this morning during huddle, and we just said, hey, how is everyone feeling? And it's really important to take a self-assessment. And it's okay if you're feeling sad. It's not like because you have faith, it doesn't mean you can't be sad or you can't be feeling something. And so we took a moment around our team this morning. We just said, hey, how are you feeling? I'd say, you know, there's a few that came out. It's like, I'm anxious, I'm scared, I'm frustrated, I'm devastated, or I'm just not able to sleep. And that's okay. But what we do with that is really important. It's important to voice those things, and it's important to kind of engage with those feelings for a moment and say, hey, this is where I'm at right now. This is where I'm at right now, but I'm not gonna stay here, because it says, do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication, let your thanksgiving and let your requests be known to God. It's not holding on to it. It's okay. I'm gonna do a self-assessment right now. We're gonna do that right now. I just want everyone just to close your eyes. This is just to help you kind of focus. Just close your eyes, and even if you want to right now, just begin to lift your hands to God and say, God, and wherever you're at, if you're in a space where you have no emotion, that's okay. If you're in a space where you have anxiety right now, that's okay. If you're in a space where you have peace right now, that's awesome. If you're in a space where you're completely terrified or you're worried right now, but right now we're going to lift those feelings to God. We're going to say, God, even in this moment, I feel anxious, God. In this moment, I feel anxious. And Lord, I am acknowledging that feeling, but God, ultimately, I am lifting it up to you and I am giving it to you. And that's why we raise our hands. We say, God, I'm giving this moment to you. God, I'm giving the control that I wish I had to you. God, I'm giving the fear to you. God, I'm giving the anxiety to you. God, I'm giving that unknown to you, God, and I'm putting it into your hands this morning, because in my hands, it's just gonna fester. In my hands, it's just gonna corrupt. In my hands, it's just gonna make me more scared. In my hands, it's gonna make me more worried. But God, I'm giving you my worry this morning. And would you just do that right now? Wherever you're at, begin to just speak to him out loud. Say, God, I'm giving you this worry. God, I'm giving you this anxiety. God, I'm giving you my faith. God, I'm giving you the rest that I have. I don't have much, but I'm giving you the rest that I have in this moment. Right now, just do that all across the room, wherever you're at. God, I'm giving it to you. I'm giving it to you. I'm giving it to you. In Jesus' name. second part of this verse. This is when we acknowledge that and we make our request known, we give it up to God. It says this, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. It passes that understanding of, I don't know what's gonna be tomorrow. I don't know, I can't fathom, I can't control anything, but it passes that understanding. And so in this moment, I just want us to go back into this song and begin to declare that I trust in God. You have to almost tell yourself, me and my wife have been, we look at each other, we say, we trust in God. Whatever situation we're in, if it's a financial situation, if it's just a tense situation, if we've just had just crazy things stack up week by week by week, and it's like never ending, we have to look at each other. We trust in God. So right now we're gonna sing that and declaring that we trust in God as KCC. We trust in God in any circumstance. It doesn't matter if our city is literally burning down. We trust in God because we trust that God's gonna drive us through. He's gonna drag us through if he needs to. But let's just sing that and declare it. Come on.
My Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. I trust in God. My Savior, the one who will never fail.
Oh,
1 Peter 5:7 says, "Cast all of your anxiety on me, for he cares for you." And as I was sitting here in worship, there's just a few scriptures that have come to mind. Psalms 34:18, "The Lord is near to the brokenhearted and saves the crushed in spirit." My flesh, this is what it says in Psalm 73, "My flesh and my heart fails, but God is the strength of my heart, my portion forever." Matthew 5:8, "Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted." Today is such a day that we get to rely on the Holy Spirit and we get to be comforted in this time. So even as we're leading into these next things, even I love what Malachi said, let's just name the frustration, name the loss that we're experiencing right now as we're seeing things happen in our province, as we're no families that are displaced, that maybe their houses have gone. Let's just name the things that are happening, leave them in God's hand, and cast that anxiety on him and say, "God, you're a good God. You will comfort me." Not if I do this, it says you will. Let's lean into his presence today and say, "Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. You are welcome in my life. Lord, I need your comfort. I need your peace. I need your joy. I need your direction. I need your purpose. I need your next move. God, what do you have for me this morning?" Are you with me, church? We're going to cast our anxieties on him. We're going to cast our burdens on him. We're going to say, "God, you've got this." Let's just lift up our voices and let the team just roll into this. I just want to lead us in prayer. God, Lord, we cast all of this on you and say, "God, even though around us it looks like it's weighing in on us, the Lord, all these things are going on, Lord, we lean on you for your comfort." Say that with me. I lean on you, God. I lean on you, God, for your presence, for your peace, for your joy in this situation. Or we cast our anxieties on you and say, "God, you are a good God." In all of this, what we see, this journey you've taken us on this morning, God, is you are a faithful God, one that we can put our trust in. Bless us. Sing this. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Let him speak to you. Let him lead you this morning in Jesus' name.
experience the glory of your goodness.
From the Lord. And the Lord says that we have to recognize this moment as what the enemy is trying to do to preempt what God wants to do. Because every time God gets ready to do something big and something powerful, the enemy wants also to go ahead and stop that, so that people focus on what the enemy is doing rather than on what God is doing. When God was ready to allow the Israelites and deliver them from Egypt, then the enemy stirred up the heart of Pharaoh to put the people in bondage. And when Jesus, the Lord Jesus, was about to be born, then the enemy stirred up, or when he was already born, the enemy stirred up Pharaoh to begin to murder the innocent ones. Each time God wants to do something big and powerful, the enemy stirs up a trouble, so that we focus on what the enemy is doing rather than what God is doing. But the Lord is saying to us this morning that I am ready to move, and I am ready to bless my people, and I am ready to walk among my people. I am ready to do something powerful and something great. It shall not be a physical fire, but it will be a spiritual fire that burns and burns in the hearts of men and women. The fire that cannot be stopped. The fire of my revival is about to break out. It's about to break out. It's about to break out. And the enemy thinks he can stop it. But beloved, I say the enemy will not be able to stop it, because people shall be healed, people shall be blessed, loved ones shall be saved. The enemy cannot stop it. The community shall be blessed. The community shall be blessed, and many hearts shall be turned to the Lord. Let us believe that this morning. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Take a seat for a moment. The team's going to continue to lead us as we begin to take communion today. So those ushers who are helping can go and prepare to serve. There, how many of you know that there was a hedge of protection for us? And that this meal signifies a hedge of protection for every believer. It was the blood that was painted over the doorposts at the Hebrew people that allowed them to remain safe and secure when a spirit of death reigned through Egypt. It moved through Egypt. It skipped the doors. The blood of Jesus has power. Amen. The blood of Jesus has power. His blood was poured out on the cross for us, for these purposes, to protect and secure and to sanctify each and every one of us. And there's a resource that we can draw upon, and we can call on the blood of Jesus. When I was young, we used to plead the blood of Jesus over our body, over our facility, over our resources, over our home. We plead the blood of Jesus that it would be marked by Him, for Him. And we believe today we're going to pray, we're going to receive communion here, and we're going to pray for our city, and that the Lord, or let's say cities, would we do that? This fire has been like larger than just Kelowna. It's been affecting cities. We're going to plead the blood of Jesus around the cities and believe God for His protection and preservation of those cities and every individual within those cities. So I'm going to invite the team to continue to worship, and then I'll come back and lead us in communion.
And fill the
Miracle-working God, don't we? It's wonderful to be in a community of faith, community of people who believe for restoration, that our God restores and rebuilds individuals, communities, cities. Our God's a restoring God. When we were listening to the from the city, there was one announcer that made one comment that really stuck with me. He commented that there would be a scar left on our city. And for some reason, when he said that, my spirit rejected it. And I heard that word, and I heard that there's going to be the scar. It's going to remain on every heart and every individual. And I said, that's a curse over our city. And I understand what he's saying, that the mountains are going to look black, but that doesn't mean that our community will be black. The people have been displaced, but that doesn't mean that we'll be forever displaced. We know that there are 35,000 people who have been evacuated and out of their homes. And to me, the fact that it's a testament to our city that those people have found places to stay and the community's opened up its arms have been actually a story of the how accepting and how welcoming and how great this city actually is. But I don't believe that there will be a scar in this city. And I believe when we come to the table, we come to the cross, I believe the whole purpose of the cross was that the Lord would take our wounds for us. And he would bear our injury and our iniquity and our pain and our suffering. And he would bear the scars on his body for us. And I believe that we can go before the Lord, we can go to him today, and we can say, Father, we remember and we recall today that this city belonged to you before it belonged to us. And you care for this city, and you care for every individual in the city. You care for every animal. How many of you believe God cares for the animals too? Every animal, every structure, every resource in this city, that God's hand is on this place. And this isn't an act of judgment. This is an act of, this is an act where we may not understand it, but it's an act that is going to return in peace. It's going to return in a restoration of something new and something different. After the fire, there's always something new, and after the pain, there's always something that's new that's come about. And I appreciate the word from Shagun today, because it's a reminder that God has got a new thing. He's got a new thing for the city. He's got a new thing planned for our community, and there's a new shift that's happened, and I've just sensed what the Lord is doing here. The fact that God never fails, that sometimes we can look at our situation, we can assess it, and we say, you know, I don't understand why it's happening, but that we lean in the fact that God never fails. He's never failed us yet. And I remember a few nights ago when the fires hit the mountains, it was a dark night. But I also remember another dark night in history. A dark night in history where when Jesus was on the cross and it seemed like it was ominous, like it was the end. But the fact is, in that moment of time, something changed in history. That Christ would bear upon himself the sins of the world and would take upon himself the judgment of sin so that we could walk in freedom. And I want to remind us today that every dark night doesn't have a light at the end of it. That every dark moment doesn't result in a forever moment. That at the end of that moment, at the end of the cross where everything seemed dark and the tomb was at the darkest point, it was after that moment that the light came. And it came to all of the people, to the whole earth, to every person on the world, to be able to receive what we can celebrate today. Would you take in your hand the bread? In 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23, it says, I received from the Lord what I also pass on to you. And the Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, a dark night, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it. And he said, this is my body, which is for you. Eat it, take it. And do it likewise. Take it likewise in remembrance of me. Would you take a moment with me? Father, we give you thanks today. We give you thanks. Despite what we see, Father, we give you thanks. We give you thanks, Father. We remember you. We remember our true Savior. Our salvation comes from you. Our healing comes from you. Our deliverance comes from you. Our freedom comes from you. Lord, our hope comes from you. The grace, the love, the mercy that we experience comes from you. What we didn't deserve, Father, your Son bore on the cross, took our penalty and washed away our judgment of criminality, our opposition to you. And you made a way to the Father for us, Jesus, that we could not make. And today we celebrate the fact that we can call to you and we can go to you and we can freely talk and speak and communicate and dialogue with you. And we thank you for that open door. Would you take this bread today together with me? Thank you, Lord. Scripture says in verse 25, in the same way, after supper, he took the cup. And he said, this is the cup of my new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it, remember me. Whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. Father, today we thank you for the blood. We thank you for the power of the blood. The fact that it announces a new start, a new beginning for each and every one of us. Thank you, Father, that the old has passed away and the new can come. And the new has started, and so many of us in this room have experienced the beauty and the transformation of a changed heart. We thank you, Father, that you took our lives and you renewed us and restored us and rebuilt us and gave us a future, not just temporal, but eternal. Our hope is in you. Our trust is in you. This new covenant says that you are our Father. You've made us sons and daughters. You've made us of the same family. And we're not alone. We're part of this great community of faith. And we celebrate, Lord, that you're looking out for us. And you're caring for us. And despite the displacement, despite the disruption in our city, Father, we know we can stand on you. And we know we have a firm foundation in you. You can be our rock and our support. You're comforting us and keeping us. And not only do you do it for us, but our cup runs over so we can be a blessing and serve others. And so, Father, today fill us fresh with this fresh perspective, a fresh life, Lord, that you purchased for us on the cross. We celebrate the blood, the life in Jesus. Amen. Take this together with me. Yeah, God. Amen. Amen. Would you give him a round of applause today? Would you celebrate him? Amen. I'm going to invite you to do something. Would you just stand your feet for a moment here? This isn't the fact that we're alone. Part of the power of this meal is the fact that we're not alone. That we have a community around us. We have a family around us. And that I want you to take a look around this room. And I want you to go to five people. And I know this is crazy. And it's ridiculous. It goes against Church 101. Make people feel comfortable and all that. But the fact is, we need one another. And I want you to give five. Let's make it 10 people. High five, fist bumps. Depending on how comfortable you are with them, give them a hug. Welcome them to church and say, you're not alone. You've got people here with you, care for you, love you, supporting you. Bless you.
Going to come or if people are going to stay home. And I got to tell you, it's so encouraging to see a church that's full and a church that is full of people that are here this morning. So we're especially glad that you're here with us this morning. And if you are particularly new to KCC, maybe you haven't been here before, we want to bless you with a coffee on your way out. So be sure to go to the connection corner. You can go to the coffee bar. Let someone know that you're new and let us bless you with a coffee on your way out. Please, please, please do that. But to all those of you that are newer, or been here a long time, we just want to also just say, hey, we're a church that we believe that gathering here, you know, as a big church is important, but we also believe in small church too. Having, you know, connect groups, life groups, whatever it is, those meetings that you do, we can't do this without our community, right? And so we just want you to get connected with us, get to know who we are. And one of the ways that you can do that is by going to our Connect Corner. So after service today, if there are more details that you kind of want to know about or what's going to come up in the fall, what groups are going to happen, go to our Connect group or Connect Corner. We'd love to share that with you as well. So we really, really, really believe in community here, and so it's just so encouraging that we have a church that's so full of faith and of wonderful people that can support each other. I'm going to invite our ushers to come on up. We're going to get ready to give our tithes and offerings as well. And so a couple of ways that you can give this morning is by filling out a Connect card that's right in front of your chairs. You can give cash if you'd like to. You can give on our app. We have a KCC app. It's fairly simple to use. I love it. Or you can give online, kcc.net. Or if you prefer to use a debit machine, we do have that available at the Connect group. There is something that has been said about tithes and offering and just the act of giving and giving faithfully and believing and sowing in something that we cannot see, and something that Pastor Brody had said, I don't know, it could be a couple years ago now, but it stuck with me ever since, and I just believe firmly that God can do so much more in the famine than the world can do at its greatest, at its best. And I just so believe that with our tithes, God can do so much more in this season of life than the world could do at its best. It doesn't even compare. And so when we give that act of faith and an act of obedience, like, God, I'm sowing into you today, and I'm believing, God, that you can do so much more with this than I can even imagine. And so as we prepare to give, I'm just going to pray really quick here. God, I thank you so much that you are faithful. God, in the world that we live in, Lord, we thank you that you are stable. God, we thank you that you are able. God, we thank you that you are generous. God, you first gave to us, Lord. And we give back to you today in faith, God, believing, God, asking, God, declaring, God, that you will do so much more with this, Lord, that it would go beyond us, beyond our time, beyond this generation, Lord. We just act and we sow and we believe and we bless this offering today. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So I have a few announcements to share with you, and it's with a sad, sad heart, but we have formally canceled our summer camp. We were going to go away today to Eagle Bay Camp with our regen team from Chilliwack, but we have had to make a really hard decision, you know, canceling that. And I know it weighs a lot, and I know there's a lot of disappointment in the kids and you know, our youth leaders, but first and foremost is the safety and priority of our kids and our families, and so we didn't do this lightly, and so we just, I'm just going to let you know that, you know, we're not going to be sending off any kids today, but we're going to continue to believe as a youth ministry. I know Pastor Malachi and I, we're excited about the fall, we're excited about what God's doing. We know that summer camp is usually a really great big week for so many kids, but that doesn't mean that God can't do that in the fall, in the winter, in the spring. It doesn't mean that it only happens in the summer. So what I'm going to ask church is, just as you think about our kids, start praying for them that as they come back to school, as they come back to youth, and we do those things, let's pray for revival to happen in that time and in that season. Amen. Amen. And so another event that we had to cancel, unfortunately, was this Connect Day that we had planned for this Saturday. We were going to have Harrison Mungle come and share with us, but we've unfortunately had to cancel. There is a travel ban in place. And so it is, again, with a sad heart that we cannot do that, but many events will come in the future, and we're just so excited to see, you know, what God is going to continue to do. Next month, we do have an event happening. Okanagan Pregnancy Care Center is having their annual benefit banquet at Evangel Church on September 1st at 6 p.m. So we do have tickets available. They are $25. And so if that is something that's near and dear to your heart and you'd like to attend, it's a great organization. It's a great event to attend. So if you are looking to purchase a ticket, we will have that available to you at the Connect Corner as well after service today. And what did I say? First, oh, I'm sorry, September 21st. Thank you so much. September 21st at 6 p.m. And so with that, I'm just going to invite Pastor Brian to come up.
So you guys got like 60 minutes for me? I'm just kidding, mostly. Whenever you give a preacher a mic, you're just in danger. So this morning, I just want to take a few minutes. I felt that we needed something to walk away with. I mean, this morning has been quite the journey. Through the worship, through the things that God said, through the things that God's done, it's been a real journey. And I want to walk away with giving you an encouragement today. You okay with that? I had someone text me during the service, Ryan, right over here, my friend Ryan, and he said this: when you turn your worry into worship, God will turn your battles into blessings. Powerful word. So this last week, I shared this with in Team Huddle. This last week, I called someone up because they had been evacuated. Talking on the phone as I'm watching the fire on the hill from my brother-in-law's house, and we're just watching this, and I called him, and I said, hey, how are you guys doing? He moved out, and just talking about, he's standing on the beach, he can look across the road, and he can actually see his house still there. As the fire is looming, it's coming down. And you know what he says to me? He quotes John 14, he said this. He said, let not your heart be troubled. I was a little shocked that someone said that. Like, you know, pastor, you shouldn't be. You're a pastor, right? Like, just all the cliches came to my head. It was just one of those moments. Man, like, man, I was so blessed by how strong he stood in that moment and said, let not your heart be troubled. He's like, God's got this. I was like, man, that's great faith that God's working through this. And as I was preparing for this morning, I had a whole different message prepared. That's going to happen next week. But this is what I want to just encourage us with in here, is that Psalms 56:3 says this, and this is David. And he's saying, when I am afraid, I put my trust in you. And God, whose word I praise, and God, I trust, I shall not be afraid. This is the powerful moment, because if we know the story of David, he's killed lions, he's killed bears, he's faced giants, he's done all kinds of things, and he's not saying he doesn't feel fear, he's saying that he feels fear, but when I feel that fear, I leave it in God's hands, I put my trust in God. The songs that we sing, the things that we've heard this morning, the stories that we're hearing in the lobby is people that are putting their faith over fear. I love how David says this, and it's such a powerful line in those 26 words of what he says. It doesn't mean that we're less of a Christian because we have fear. I've actually heard people say that to me. Well, I have fear, so I'm not believing God. No. Those two things can coexist. David is saying, when I am afraid, I will trust in you. Such a powerful statement. He said he feared. But what we see with David is that the fear didn't rule. The fear didn't control his actions. The fear didn't control what he had to do. Courage isn't the absence of fear. It's doing the right thing when you're facing fear. We stand up, even though this is, you know, someone said to me this morning, said, I just feel so helpless. I felt the same thing over the weekend. I wanted to grab a shovel and go stand next to a firefighter and work as hard as I can to help them. I felt helpless. But we have a God who we serve who isn't helpless. Amen? If David was here and he would say to us, he said, I am sometimes afraid. He would say to us, I am afraid. But I trust in God and I will do what is right. And this is where I want to just lean on some of the promises of God this morning. This is what he says. He says, I will praise his word. I love this. Because in the midst of everything he's going through, in the midst of his fear, in the midst of facing bears, in the midst of facing lions, all the things that he's gone through, he's declaring his trust in God, but he calls attention to the trustworthiness of God's word in that moment. And we're a Bible-believing church that believes that his word is true, and it's the God-breathed word that he has given us. You with me? And here's the encouragement. His trust wasn't blind or wish that he cast upon. It was based in God's revealed character and his revealed promises. So even as we've been talking this morning, what have we even been hearing? God's faithfulness. That his character has shown true. That people, yes, they're suffering. We're experiencing pressure. There's stress on all sides of us. But we're leaning into who God is and we're putting our trust in him. So here's just five promises that the word says so we can lean on this for this coming the coming time. Number one, God promises to strengthen you. Ephesians 3:14 says, for this reason I bow my knee before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named, that according to the riches of his glory, he may grant you to be strengthened with power through his spirit in your inner being. When you don't have strength, he will give you strength. Second promise, God promises to give you rest. Matthew 11, 28 to 30 says, come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden. That could be some of us this morning. And I will, there's a promise, I will, strong word, give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. You learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will rest, find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. We're feeling that weight, we put our trust in him. Third promise, God promises to take care of all your needs. Philippians 4:19, and my God will supply every need according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus. Faith over fear. God's promises, number four, God's promises to answer your prayers. Matthew 7:7 says, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it will be opened unto you. These are some of the songs that we've been singing this morning. I sought the Lord and he answered. You with me? Fifth promise. God promises to work everything out for your good. Romans 8:28. If we know that those who love God, all things work together for good for those who are called according to his purpose. So here's one I want to, there's two things I want to pray for before we leave today. I want to end with this. When these things happen and we come together as a church and we stand together and we worship together, it builds our faith. It brings us together. That means we can stand with each other. Galatians says, bear one another's burdens. There's someone around you that you know is struggling. Go pray with them. Go encourage them. Go lift them up. That's what we do as a biblical faith community. We raise each other up. We don't tear each other down. We build each other up. When we do this, we walk through these things together. So when one suffers, we all suffer. This church stands for faith that God's going to move mountains. That we stand for each other and we're going to worship God. Can you stand with me? I just want to lead us in a prayer and actually start with, there's two things I want to pray for. One, I want to lead us as we pray for all of our first responders and firefighters that are out there. We need to just, God's got to give them strength and wisdom and energy and just a sight that is the supernatural. And the second thing is we're going to pray for rain. You need faith the size of a mustard seed. We're going to pray that whatever winds need to blow, they blow in the proper direction, or no winds at all. We're going to pray that God's going to lay, just rain down and just give the all that we need, that we're going to, he's just going to just take care of this for us. Are you with me? Can we stand in faith together? So let's just start. I just want to pray. Just lift up your voices. We're just going to pray for these firefighters. God, you're a good God. Today, it's faith over fear. Lord, as these firefighters, these men and these women that stand in the face of this fire and they fight with courage, Lord, that every single one of them, you give them the strength, the wisdom, the energy, the sight that they need to see what the fire is doing, Lord, how they can support each other, Lord, that our community around us and all of Kelowna and all of the Okanagan and all these places, Lord, will just wrap them up with our community and our hospitality and say, God, Lord, we give them strength, we give them food, we give them water, whatever we need as a church, as a community. Lord, we just ask that you give them all the strength that they need. Lord, to be able to move into the place that you have given them wisdom to do, strength to do, energy to do, Lord, and just a courage in their hearts that to just face this thing head on. Lord, thank you for all of the ones that have come from other countries, that have come from other provinces to support this community, Lord. Bless them and take care of them, Lord. We want no loss of life from these firefighters in Jesus' name and first responders of any kind. Lord, now we're going to stand in faith together as a church, God, and say, Lord, we're praying for rain. I want you to lift your voice, church. Lift your voice, church. We just want, Lord, we need your supernatural wisdom. We need your supernatural rain to change how things move. Lord, whatever the wind needs to do, Lord, that your hand is directing it so it snuffs out that fire in Jesus' name. Lord, that there would be a torrential downpour that is only, people can't know what it is. It wasn't in the news, Lord. It was just that your rain was coming, Lord. Your rain was going to come. And it's just a testimony of your power, Lord. We are standing in faith, extending our faith into something that needs to be done for our community, for our province, for our people, for our friends and families, houses, their animals, Lord, that your rain would come. Lord, and that we don't just pray for it on a Sunday, Lord. We pray for it when we go home. We pray for it this afternoon. And we're believing, God, that your Holy Spirit is going to just, Lord, your power can move mountains, Lord. And that's what we're calling on. Are you with me, church? Let's just raise our voices to him and say, God, we need your rain. Thank you, Jesus, Lord. We need your rain this morning. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Worthy is your
of Jesus. He's a good God. He's good. Today, tomorrow, he is good. May the Lord bless you. May he keep you. May his face shine upon you. May he be gracious to you. Lift up his countenance over you. May the Lord give you peace. In Jesus' name, make you strong. Turn to your neighbor. May the Lord make you strong. That's right. Make you strong today. Amen. God bless you. Take some time to connect with people out in the lobby. If you're with us for the first time, grab a latte. Go to the coffee bar. We'd love to meet you and connect with you. Bless you.